Our next talk is called Safe Harbor. Background is, back in October, in the light of the Snowden revelations, the Court of Justice of the European Union, that's the EuGH in German, declared the Safe Harbor agreement between the EU and the US invalid. This talk is about how we got there, as well as further implications of that decision. Please believe me when I say our speaker is ideally suited to talk about that topic. Please give it up for the man actually suing Facebook over data protection concerns, Max Schrems.
Hey. It's cheerful, like some Facebook annual conference where the newest things are kind of presented. I'm doing a little intro, basically where I got there. This was my nice little university in California, and I was studying there for half a year, and there were a couple of people from Facebook and other big companies, and they were talking about European data protection law. And the basic thing they said, it was not the original quote, but basically what they said is, fuck the Europeans, you can fuck their law as much as you want and nothing is going to happen. And that was kind of the start of the whole story, because I thought, okay, let's just make a couple of complaints and see where it goes. I originally got 1,200 pages Facebook data back then, because you can make a, you can exercise your right to access. And Facebook actually sent me a CD with a PDF file on it with all my Facebook data. It was by far not everything, but it was the first time that someone really got the data, and I was asking someone from Facebook why they were so stupid to send me all this information, because a lot of it was obviously illegal. And the answer was, we had internal communications problems. So someone was just stupid enough to burn it on a CD and send it on. One of the CDs actually was first going to Sydney in Australia, because they put Australia instead of Austria on the label, which was one of the things as well. Anyway, so this was basically how my interest in Facebook started, and the media got crazy about it, because there's like a little guy that does something against a big guy. And this is basically how the whole thing got to speak. This is like a cartoon from my Salzburg newspaper. This should be me, and it's like basically the reason why the story got that big, because it's a small guy doing something against Facebook. Not necessarily because what I was doing was so especially smart, but the story was just good for the media, because data protection is generally a very dry topic that they can't report about, and there they had like the guy that did something. A couple of introductions. We actually had three procedures. So if you heard about what I was doing, there was originally a procedure at the Irish Data Protection Commissioner on Facebook itself, so what Facebook itself does with the data. This procedure has ended after 3 years. There's a class action in Vienna right now that's still ongoing. It's in front of the Supreme Court in Austria right now. And there is the procedure that I'm talking about today, which is the procedure on Safe Harbor at the Irish Data Protection Commissioner. A couple of other background informations. I personally don't think Facebook is the issue. Facebook is just a nice example for an overall bigger issue. So I was never personally concerned with Facebook, but it's more for me, the question is how we enforce data protection, all kind of stuff. So it's not a Facebook talk, Facebook is the example. And of course, the whole thing is just one puzzle piece. A lot of people are saying, you know, this was one win, but there are so many other issues. Yes, you're totally right, this was just one issue, but you got to start somewhere. And the whole thing is also not an ultimate solution, so I cannot present you the final solution for everything, but probably a couple of possibilities to do something. If you're interested in the documents, we pretty much publish everything on the webpage. It's a very old-style webpage, but you can download the PDF files and everything if you're interested in like the facts and the nitty-gritty details. Talking about facts, the whole thing started with the Snowden case, where we kind of, for the first time, had documents proving who is actually forwarding data to the NSA in this case. And this is the interesting part, because we have a lot of rumors, but if you're in a courtroom, you actually have to prove everything, and you cannot just suspect that very likely they're doing it, but you need actual proof. And thanks to Snowden, we had at least a bunch of information that we could use. These are the slides, you all know them. The first very interesting thing was the FISA Act, and we mainly argued under 1881A as an example for the overall surveillance in the US. So we took this law as an example, but it was not the only thing we relied on. And I think it's interesting for Europeans to understand how the law actually works. The law actually goes after data, not after people. we typically have laws or laws in criminal procedures that go after people. This law goes after data. So it totally falls outside of our normal thinking of we're going after a suspect, someone that may have committed a crime. Basically, the law says that there is an electronic communication service provider that holds foreign intelligence information. That's much more than just terrorist prevention. That's also things that the US is generally interested in. And this is the level that's publicly known, and everything else is basically classified. So under the law, the FISA court can do a certification for 1 year that basically says the NSA can access data. In these certifications, there are these minimization and targeting procedures that they have to describe, but they're not public. We don't know how they look like. And basically, they're here to separate data from US people out of the data set. So it doesn't really help a European. And then there is a so-called directive that goes to the individual service provider, which basically says, give us the data in some technical format. So very likely it's some kind of API or some kind of possibility that they can retrieve the data. That's what the law says. We don't know how it actually looks, and we don't have perfect proof of it. So there are a lot of things that are disputed, and they're still disputed by the US government. So the exact technical implementations, the amount of data that's actually pulled, all the review mechanisms they have internally, that's all stuff that was not 100% sure and not sure enough to present it to a court, which was the basic problem we had. First of all, after the Snowden thing broke, we had different reactions, and that was kind of how I started the procedure. The first reaction was demonstrations, where we're all walking in the streets, which is good and which is important, but we all know that this is something we have to do, but not something that's going to change the world. Second thing, we had parliaments like the European Parliament doing resolutions saying that we should strike down the safe harbor and this is all bad and evil. We had the Commission pretty much saying the same thing. We had national politicians saying the same thing. And we all knew that basically this means that they all send an angry letter to the US. Then they can walk in front of the media and say, yes, we've done something. We sent an angry letter to the US. And the US is just thrown basically in some trash bin of crazy Europeans wanting strange things, and that was it. So I was actually called by a journalist and asked if there's some other option, and I was then starting to think about it, and there's the so-called Safe Harbor Agreement. To explain the Safe Harbor, in Europe we have data protection law that is on the papers, but factually not enforced, but at least in theory we have it. And we have a couple of other countries that have the same level of protection or similar laws. And generally, data protection only works if you keep the data within the protected sphere, so you're not allowed to send personal data to a third country that doesn't have adequate protection. There are a couple of other countries that do, and therefore you can transfer data, for example, to Switzerland. This is what the law says. And there are certain servers that are outside these countries where we can have contractual relationships. So basically, if you have a server in India, you have a contract with your Indian hosting provider saying you apply proper data protection to it, so you can transfer data there too. All of this is approved by the European Commission. This is how data flows legally outside of the European Union, personal data. This all doesn't apply to any other kind of data, only personal data. And we had a basic problem with the US because there was this directive saying you can't forward data to other countries, but there is no data protection law in the US. So basically, you wouldn't be allowed to send data there unless you have some contractual relationship, which is always kind of complicated. So the solution was to have a self-certification to European Union principles, and this was put into an executive decision by the European Commission. So basically, how Safe Harbor is working is that, for example, Google can walk up and say, hereby I pledge that I follow European data protection law. I solemnly swear. And then they do whatever they want to do, and basically that's the Safe Harbor system, and the Europeans can walk around and say, yeah, there is some seal saying that everything is fine, so don't worry. Everybody knew that this is a fucked up system, but for years and years everyone was looking away because politics is there and economics is there and they just needed it. So basically Safe Harbor works that way that a US company can follow these Safe Harbor principles and say we follow them. Then the Federal Trade Commission and private arbitrators are overlooking them in theory, in practice they never do. And this whole thing was packaged into a decision by the European Commission. And this is the so-called safe harbor system. So from a legal point of view, from a European legal point of view, it's not an agreement with the US. It's a system that the US has set up that we approved as adequate. So there's no binding thing between the US and Europe. We can kind of trash it anytime. They've just never done that. Which brings me to the legal argument. Basically, if I'm this little smiley down there, I'm sitting in Austria and transfer my data to Facebook Ireland because worldwide, 82% of all users have a contract with Facebook Ireland, anyone that lives outside the US and Canada. So anyone from China, South America, Africa has a contract with Facebook in Ireland. And legally, they forward the data to Facebook in the US. Technically, the data is directly forwarded, so the data is actually flowing right to the servers in the US. However, legally, it goes through Ireland. And my contract partner is an Irish company. And under the law, they can only transfer data to the US if there's adequate protection. At the same time, we know that the prison system is hooked up in the end. So I was basically walking up to the court and saying, mass surveillance is very likely not adequate protection, huh? And that was basically the argument. Yeah. The interesting thing in this situation was actually the strategic approach. So we have the NSA and other surveillance organizations that use private companies. So we have kind of a public-private surveillance partnership. It's PPP in a kind of surveillance way. Facebook is subject to US law, so under US law, they have to forward all the data. At the same time, Facebook Ireland is subject to European law, so they're not allowed to forward all this data, which is interesting because they're split. And the EU law regulates how these third country transfers work, and all of this has to be interpreted under fundamental rights. So this was basically the system we were looking at. And the really crucial thing is that we have this public-private surveillance, because we do have jurisdiction over a private company. We don't have jurisdiction over the NSA. We can send angry letters to the NSA. But we do have jurisdiction over Facebook, Google, and so on, because they're basically based here. Mainly for tax reasons. And this was the interesting thing, that in difference to the national surveillance, where we can pretty much just send the angry letters, we can do something about the private companies. And without the private companies, there is almost no mass surveillance in this scale, because the NSA is not in our phones. It's the Googles and Apples and whatever. And without them, you don't really, you're not really able to get this mass surveillance. This is like a legal chart. Basically, what we argued is there's 7 and 8 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights. That's your right to privacy and your right to data protection. There is an article in the directive that has to be interpreted in light of it. Then there's the executive decision of the European Union. This is basically the Safe Harbor decision, which refers to paragraph 4 of the Safe Harbor principles. And the Safe Harbor principles basically say that the FISA Act is okay. So you have kind of this circle of different legal layers, which is getting really crazy. And I'll try to break it down a little bit. Basically, 7 and 8 of the Charter, we basically compared to data retention, so the Vorratsdatenspeicherung. We basically said PRISM is much worse. If Vorratsdatenspeicherung and data retention was invalid, then PRISM has to be 10 times as bad. That was basically the argument, very simple. We just compared, the one was content data, the other one was metadata, the one is storage, the other one is making available, and the one is endless, the other one is 24 months. So basically in all these categories, PRISM was much worse. And if the one has to be legal, the other one has to be as well. And what's interesting, and that's something that the US side is typically not getting, is that Article 8 is already covering making available of data. So the fun thing is, I only had to prove that Facebook makes data available, so basically it's possible the NSA is pulling it. I didn't even have to prove that the NSA is factually pulling my personal data. And this was like the relevant point, because under US law, basically your fundamental rights only kick in when they factually look at your data and actually surveil you. So I was only, they're making it available, that's good enough for me, which was making all these factual evidence much easier. So basically, I only had to say, look at the X-Keyscore slides where they say username Facebook. They can get somehow the data out of it. It's at least made available. That's all I need to prove. And this is the big difference between the US, it's very simplified, but basically between the US approach and the European approach, is that in the US, you have to prove that your data is actually pulled. I only had to prove that my data is made available. So I was able to get out of all the factual questions. This is a comparison. You basically, in the US, you have very strict laws for certain types of surveillance, while in Europe, you have a more flexible system that covers much more. So it's a different approach that we just have in the two legal spheres. We're both talking about your fundamental right to privacy, but in details it's very different, and that's kind of the difference is what we used. The fun thing is, if you're European, you don't have any rights in the US anyways, because the Bill of Rights only applies to people that live in the US and US citizens, so you're out of luck anyways. So you're only left with the European things. Basically, the law, which is the second level after the fundamental rights, is saying that there has to be an adequate level of protection, as I said, and this third country has to ensure it by domestic law or international commitments. And I was saying, you know, there's the FISA Act, you can read it, it definitely doesn't ensure your fundamental rights and an adequate protection, so we're kind of out of Article 25. And there is paragraph 4 of the Safe Harbor Principles, which say that all these wonderful privacy principles that U.S. companies sign up to do not apply whenever a national law in the U.S. is overruling it. So there are principles that companies say we follow, but if there is a city in Texas saying we have a local ordinance saying you have to do differently, all these Safe Harbor Principles don't apply anymore. And this is the fundamental flaw of a self-certification system, that it only works if there is no law around that conflicts with it. And as there are tons of laws that conflict with it, you're hardly able to hold up a system like that. So basically, if you go through all these different legal layers, you end up with a conflict between the US FISA Act and the European fundamental rights. So you're going through different layers of the system, but you're basically making a circle. And this is what we did, which was a little bit complicated, but it worked. Basically now to the procedure, so how the whole thing happened. First, I went through the Safe Harbor. Safe Harbor allows you to go to TrustE or the Federal Trade Commission, and you can actually, there's an online form to make your complaint. And I was making a complaint, and I think you were only allowed to put in 60 characters to explain what your complaint is, which is a little bit complicated if you're trying to explain NSA mass surveillance. So I only wrote, "Stop Facebook Inc.'s involvement in PRISM." That was everything I could actually put in the text box. That was the absolute maximum. And the answer I got back was, "TrustE does not have the authority to address the matter you raise." Which is obvious, it's a private arbitration company that can hardly tell Facebook to not follow the NSA's guidelines. So this was the arbitration mechanism under Safe Harbor. You can also go to the Federal Trade Commission and have your complaint filed there, but they basically just don't ignore them. This was the letter I got back that they received it. But I was talking to the people at the Federal Trade Commission and say, yeah, we get these complaints, but they're ending up in a huge storage system where they stay forever after. So this was enforcement done by Safe Harbor. And we knew that in the private field already, but in this case it was especially interesting. To be fair, both of these institutions have no power to do anything about mass surveillance, so there was really a reason why they didn't do anything. The next step you have is the National Data Protection Commissioner. So we have 28 countries, with 28 plus Germany has, I think, a data protection commissioner in every province. And you end up at this, and this is my most favorite slide. This is the Irish Data Protection Commissioner. And to be super precise, I don't know if you can see the laser pointer, but this is a supermarket, and this is the Irish Data Protection Commissioner back there. To be a little more fair, actually, they're up here, and they're like 20 people when we filed it originally. The fun thing is, back at the times, they didn't have a single lawyer and not a single technician, so there were 20 public employees that were dealing with data protection, and no one had any clue of the technical or the legal things about it. The fun thing is, this is Billy Hawkes, the data protection commissioner at the time. He went on the national radio in the morning, and in Ireland, radio is a really big thing, so there was a morning show, and he was asked about these complaints. And he actually said on the radio, "I don't think it will come much as a surprise that the US services have access to all the US companies." And this was the craziest thing. I was sitting in front of the radio and was like, strike! He just acknowledged that all this is true. And the second thing he said is, US surveillance operation is not an issue of data protection. Interesting. It's actually online, you can listen to it. But the fun thing was really that the factual level is so hard to prove. that I was afraid that they would dispute, who knows if all this is true, we don't have any evidence, the companies say we're not engaging in all of this. So having the data protection commissioner saying, sure, they surveil you, are you surprised, was great, because we're kind of out of the whole factual debate. And I actually got a letter back from them saying that they're not investigating any of it. And I was asking them why. And they were naming two sections of the law, a combination thereof. So there is one thing where it says they shall investigate, which means they have to, or they may investigate. And they say they only may investigate complaints, and they just don't feel like investigating imprisonment and Facebook and all of this. Secondly, they say that a complaint could be frivolous and vexatious. I love the word, and therefore they're not investigating it, a combination thereof, or indeed any other relevant matter. So we transferred this letter into a picture, which is basically what they said. So why did you not investigate PRISM? Is shall means may, frivolous or vexatious, a combination of A and B or any other reason. So this was the answer by the Irish Data Protection Commissioner why they wouldn't want to investigate the complaint. Just to give you background information, these are the complaints that the Irish Data Protection Commissioner is receiving, the blue line, and the red line is all of the complaints they're not deciding, which is 96 to 98% of the complaints they receive on an average year, which is interesting because you have a right to get a decision, but they don't. To give you the bigger picture, we also made complaints on Apple and all the other PRISM companies, and Ireland basically said what I just told you. Luxembourg, where Skype and Microsoft is situated, said that they do not have enough evidence for the participation of Microsoft and Skype. And the funniest thing about the answer was that they said that they're restricted by their investigations to the territory of Luxembourg. And since all of this is happening in the US, they have no way of ever finding out what was going on. So I was telling them, you know, most of it is online, and if you're not able to download it, I can print it out for you and ship it to Luxembourg. But the problem is why we didn't go down in Luxembourg is because they went down this factual kind of argument. They said it's all illegal, but factually we don't believe it's true. And then it was Germany that are still investigating until today. This was Yahoo. Actually, there was Yahoo in Munich, but they now moved to Ireland as well. So I don't know what happened to this complaint. We never heard back. But whenever we send an email, they were like, oh, we're still investigating. So what happened now is that I went to the Irish High Court to jeopardize the non-decision of the Irish Data Protection Commissioner. This is the case that then went down as Schrems versus the Data Protection Commissioner, which is so strange because I never wanted to have my name on any of this, and now the decision is actually called after my second name, which is always freaking me out in a way, because you're fighting for privacy and suddenly your name is all over the place. This is the Irish High Court, so it's very complicated to get a procedure like that. The biggest issue is that you need money. If you are in front of an Irish court and you lose a case, you end up with a legal bill of a couple of €100,000, which is the reason why never anybody ever challenged the Irish Data Protection Commissioner, because you're just going to lose your house over it. So what I did is we did a little bit of crowdfunding. And we actually got about €70,000 out of it. This was a crowdfunding platform that basically worked in a way that people could donate. And if we don't need the money, we either donate it to another privacy cause, or we actually give people the money back, which we're going to have to do because we won the case, and all our costs are paid by the other side. So the fun thing is you then have to walk into this wonderful old court here on Mondays at 11:30. And there is a room where you can make your application. And about 100 other people making their application as well, and there is no number. So there are 100 lawyers sitting in a room waiting for the judge to call out their case. So we're sitting there until 4 in the afternoon or something, until suddenly our case was called up. And we actually got kind of the possibility to bring our case, and then it's postponed to another date and blah, 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 blah. In the end, you end up with something like this, which is all the paperwork, because in Ireland, the legal, the courts are not computerized so far. So you have to bring all the paperwork, anything you rely on, in 3 copies, and it's all paper noted of the pages. So all these copies have pages, 1 to 1,000. Someone is writing all of them on the page, and then they copy 3 times, and it's then in this wonderful little thing. I thought it's great. And what happened is that we walked into the judge's room and you get a judge assigned on the same day. So you end up in front of a judge that has never heard about privacy, never heard about Facebook, and never heard about Snowden, imprisonment, any of this. So you walk into the room, it's like, we would like to debate the safe harbor with you. And he's like, what the fuck is the safe harbor? So what happened is that he told us to kind of explain what it is for 15 minutes. And then he postponed the whole thing for 2 hours, I think, and we walked over to a pub and had a beer so that the judge could remotely read what he's about to look into. And Ireland is very interesting because you need a solicitor and a counsel, and then the counsel is actually talking to the judge. So I actually had two filters. If I'm the client down here, I had to talk to my solicitor. The solicitor is telling the counsel what to say to the judge. So half of this was lost on the way. And when I was asking if I could just address the judge personally, they were like, nope, no way that you could possibly address the judge personally, even though you're the client. Which is funny because they talk about this person in the room. It's like, what's the problem of this Mr. Schrems? And you're like sitting right here, it's like, this would be me. But yeah. So what happened in Ireland is that we had about 10 reasons why under Irish law, the Irish Data Protection Commissioner would have to do its job. But the court actually swiped all of this from the table and said, actually the safe harbor is the issue, which legally they're not allowed to do, but politically it was very wise, and forwarded this wonderful, easy to understand question to the European Court of Justice. The reason why they put this kind of very random question is that if you jeopardize a law in Ireland, you have to get some advocate general engaged, and they didn't want to do that, so they kind of ask a question around the actual question to not really get them engaged, which was very complicated because we didn't know how the European Court of Justice is going to react to this random question because it was so broad that they could just walk any other direction and not address the real issue. What was wonderful is that in the judgment by the Irish court, they have actually said that all of this is factually true. All the mass surveillance is factually true. And the fun thing to understand is that the factual assessment is done by the national courts. So the European Court of Justice is not engaging in factual matters anymore. They only ask legal questions. Is this legal or not? So we had a split of responsibility. The Irish court only said that all of this is true, and Luxembourg only said that all of this would be legal if all of this would be true, and, which was kind of an interesting situation. But to be fair, no one before the European Court of Justice has ever questioned that this is true. So even the UK that was in front of the court, and that you possibly know if all of this is true or not, they have never questioned the facts. So there is a pretty good factual basis. What was interesting as well is that I said I'm not going to go in front of the European Court of Justice, because the costs are so high that even the 60 or 70,000 euros I got in donations wouldn't cover it. And I knew the judge wants to get this hot potato off his table and down to Luxembourg. So I was asking for a so-called protective cost order, which kind of tells you beforehand that there is a maximum amount you have to pay if you lose a case. And it was actually the first one to ever get a protective cost order in Ireland granted, which was really cool. And the Irish were like outraged about it too. And so we basically walked into the European Court of Justice, which is a really hefty procedure. You're in this room where 13 judges are in front of you. The European Court of Justice has assigned you to the Great Chamber. So there's a small, a medium, and a Great Chamber, which is the highest thing you can possibly end up in Europe. And it's chaired by the president of the European Court of Justice. And this is kind of where the really, really basic, really important questions are dealt with. So I was like, cool, I'm getting to the European Court of Justice. And it's funny because all the lawyers that were in the room, everyone was like, I can flash in front of the European Court of Justice. They all took pictures like they were in Disneyland or something. And it was, lawyers can be very kind of, yeah, interesting. And we ended up in front of these three major people. It was the president, Thomas von Dunwich, who is the German judge, and he also wrote the lead decision. He's the judge rapporteur, so within the 13 judges, there's one that is the reporting judge and actually drafts the whole case. And he was also doing the data retention. And then it was Eve Bott as the advocate general. The hearing was interesting because we got questions from the European Court of Justice before the hearing. And in these questions, they were actually digging down into the core issues of mass surveillance in the US. When I got the questions, I was like, we won the case, because there is no way they can decide differently as soon as they address the question. There were participants from all over Europe. These are the countries. Then there was the European Parliament, the European Data Protection Supervisor, and the European Commission. There was me, MS, down there, the Data Protection Commissioner, and Digital Rights Ireland. And what was interesting was the countries that were not there. Like Germany, for example, was not there in this major procedure. And as far as I've heard, there were reasons of not getting too engaged in the transatlantic partnership, blah. So this was kind of interesting because like the UK walked up, but Germany was like, no, we rather don't want to say anything about this. What was interesting as well is that there were interventions by the US government. So I heard we were on a Tuesday, we were actually in the court, and on Mondays I got text messages from people of these different countries telling me that the US just called them up. And I was like, this is interesting because I know a lot of these people from conferences and stuff. So they were like telling me, the US just called me up and said they want to talk to my lead supervisor and tell me what to say tomorrow in the court. I was like, this is very interesting. And I was actually in the courtroom and there was the chief justice, or like the justice person from the US embassy to the European Union. And he was actually watching the procedure and watching what everybody was arguing. Well, I had a feeling this is like a watchdog situation. And someone pointed out that this is the guy, so I knew who it is. And he was walking up to me, he was like, are you the plaintiff? And I was like, yeah, hey. And he was like, trying to kind of talk to me. And I was like, so did you manage calling everybody by now, or do you still need a couple of numbers? And he was like, staring at me, he was like, he didn't just ask this question. And I was like, he was like, no, we are in contact with all of our colleagues. And of course, we have to kind of push for the interest of the US and blah, blah, blah. I was like, this is very interesting. But anyways, it didn't help them. No one of them was really kind of arguing for the US, actually. The findings of the European Court of Justice, so what was in the judgment in the end? First of all, safe harbor is invalid, which was like the big news, and this was overnight. We were expecting that they would have a grace period, so it's invalid within 3 months or something like this, but they were like in the minute they were saying it there, all your data transfers to the US were suddenly legal, which was kind of big. The second biggie was that they actually said that the essence of your rights is violated. Now, this for an average person doesn't mean too much, but for a lawyer, it's like, oh my God, the essence is touched. To explain to you what the essence is and why everybody's so excited about it is basically if you have a violation of your rights, you have no interference. So if a policeman was walking down the street and watching you, there's no interference with any of your rights. If they probably tap your phone, there is some kind of proportionality issue, which is what we typically debate before a court. There is like a system how you argue if something is proportionate or not. So for example, data retention was not proportionate, and data retention would be somewhere here probably. So not legal anymore, but still in the proportionality test. And then there is the essence, which means whatever the fuck you're trying to do here is totally illegal because what you're doing is so much out of the scale of proportionality that it will never be legal. And on data retention, they actually said that for the first time. And and this was actually the first time, as far as I saw, that the European Court of Justice has ever said that under the convention. So the convention is only in place until since 2008, I think. But it's the first time they actually found that in a case, which was huge for law in general. There was a couple of findings on data protection powers that are not too interesting for you. What may be interesting is that there is a story to this picture, that's the reason I put it in, but anyways. Basically, they said that a third country doesn't have to provide adequate protection, as I said before. So the story was that third countries originally had to provide equivalent protection. But there was lobbying going on, so the word equivalent was changed to adequate. And adequate means basically nothing, because anything and nothing can be adequate. Adequate has no legal meaning. I mean, if you ask what an adequate dressing is, you don't really know. So they changed that actually back to the law, to the wording that was lobbied out of the law, and said it has to be essentially equivalent, and that's how we now understand adequate, which is cool, because any third country now has to provide more or less the same level of protection that Europe has. It has to be effective detention and supervision mechanisms, and there has to be legal redress. Just a really short thing on the picture. I was actually just pointing at two people, and they were taking a picture from down there to make it a victory sign, and that's how the media is then like, ew! I have to speed up a little bit, not too much, but a little bit. The future, and I think that's probably relevant for you guys as well. First of all, what does this whole judgment mean? First of all, the US is basically lost its privileged status as being a country that provides adequate protection, which is kind of the elephant in the room that everyone knew anyways, that they're not providing it, and now officially they're not providing it anymore. And the US is now like any third country, so like China or Russia or India or any country we usually transfer data to. So it's not like you cannot transfer data to the US anymore, but they lost their special status. Basically what the judgment said, you can't have mass surveillance and be at the same time an adequate protecting country, which is kind of logical anyways. The consequences is that you have to use the derogations that are in law that we have for other countries as well. So a lot of people said, you know, the only result will be that there will be a consent box saying, I consent that my data is going to the US. Now the problem is consent has to be freely given, informed, unambiguous, and specific under European law, which is something all the Googles and Facebooks in the world have never understood. That's the reason why all these privacy policies are typically invalid, but anyways. So if you have any of these wordings that they're currently using, like your data is subject to all applicable laws, it's very likely not informed and unambiguous, because you don't have any fucking idea that your data is ending up at the NSA if you read this. So what they would have to do is to have some policy saying, I agree that all my personal data is made available to the NSA, FBI, and whatsoever. Yes, no. Because it has to be freely given, so I have to have the option to say no. Now, this was theoretically be possible, but under US law, they're placed under gag order, so they're not allowed to say this. So they're in a legal kind of limbo, because on the one hand, they have to say it's this way, but the other side, they have to say, no, it's not. So consent is not going to give you any solution. Then there are standard contractual clauses. That's the one from Apple that they're using right now. And standard contractual clauses allow you to have a contract with a country, with a provider in a third country, that pledges you to you in a contract that all your data is safe. The problem is that they have exception clauses that basically say if there is mass surveillance, your whole contract is void because you cannot have a contract saying, hereby I pledge full privacy and at the same time be subject to these laws. And this is the interesting thing. All these companies are saying now we're doing standard contractual clauses, but none of them are going to hold up in courts. And everybody knows, but of course to their shareholders, they have to say, oh, we have a wonderful solution for this. The big question here is if we have a factual or legal assessment. So do we have to look at factually what data is actually processed by the NSA and what are they actually doing? Or do we just have to look at the laws in the country and the possibility of mass access? So the factual assessment works fine for Apple, Google, and so on, who are all in these Snowden slides. If you look at the abstract and legal assessment, which is legally the thing that probably you have to do, you actually end up with questions like Amazon. Amazon was not a huge cloud provider when the Snowden slides were actually drafted and written. They're huge now, and very likely they're subject to all of these laws. So how do we deal with a company like this? Can we still forward data to an Amazon cloud if we know they're subject to these US laws? So this is the question of which country, companies are actually falling under this whole judgment. Basically, you still have a couple of other exemptions. So this basic thing that a couple of people said is like you're not allowed to book a hotel in the US anymore is not true. There are a lot of exceptions in the law, for example, the performance of a contract. So if I book a hotel in New York online, my data has to go to New York to actually book my hotel. So in all these cases, you can still transfer data. The ruling is mainly on outsourcing. So if you could theoretically have your data in Europe, you're just not choosing because it's cheaper to host it in the US, or it's easier, or it's more convenient. In these cases, we actually get problems. So what we did is we had a second round of complaints that is now taking these judgments on board. You can download them on the webpage as well. And there's also these, the deal that Facebook Ireland with Facebook US has signed to have safety to your data. And this is currently under investigation in Ireland. Basically, I argue that they have a contract, but the contract is void because US law says they have to do all this mass surveillance. I just got the letter that on November 18th, Facebook is actually giving them a huge amount of information on what they're actually doing with the data. And this is now going to be under investigation. The big question is if the Data Protection Commission in Ireland is actually giving us access to this information. Because so far, all this evidence that they had, they said, it's all secret and you cannot know what Facebook is doing with your data, even though you're fully informed about what they're doing with your data. Which is kind of interesting as well, but different issue. A big question was also if there's going to be a Safe Harbor 2.0. I already was told by everybody they're not going to call it a safe harbor anymore because they're stuck with media headlines like safe harbor is sunk or something like this. And what happened is that the US has done a huge lobbying effort. They have said right on the day that all of this is based on wrong facts and they've never done any of this and all of this is a trade war and blah, 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 blah. So they put a lot of pressure on them. I was actually talking to Jourova, the Justice Commissioner, and I was impressed by her. She actually took a whole hour and she really knew what was going on. And at the time they had press releases saying we're really deeply working on a new safe harbor. And I was asking her, did you get any of the evidence that you need to make such a finding? And the answer was, yeah, we're still waiting for it. We should get it next week. And which basically meant this is never going to work out anymore. But of course, I think there's a blame game going on. The European Union has to say we tried everything to find a solution. And the US is saying we tried everything to find a solution too. And then in the end, they will blame each other for not finding a solution. That's my guess, but we'll see what happened. The basic problem with a safe harbor too is that in the government sector, they would basically have to rewrite the whole US legal system, which they haven't done for their own citizens, so they will very likely not do it for European citizens. Like judicial redress, not even an American has judicial redress, so they would never give that to European. And the private area, they actually have to redraft the whole safe harbor principles because they now have to be essentially equivalent of what Europe is doing. So this would also protect people in the private sphere much more, but it would really take a major overhaul of the whole system. To give you an idea, all of these processing operations are covered by European law, so from collection all the way to really deleting the data. This is what's covered by the safe harbor principles. Only two operations, which is a disclosure by transmission and a change of purpose. Anything else they can do as freely as they want to do under the current safe harbor thing. So if you talk about essentially equivalent, you see it on these bases already that this is miles apart. So what is the future of EU-US data flows? We will have massive problems for the PRISM companies because what they're doing is just a violation of our fundamental rights. Give or take it, you can change the law as much as you want to, you cannot change the fundamental rights. And you will have serious problems for businesses that are subject to US surveillance law in general. So I'm wondering what the final solution is, and that was part of the issue that I had with the case, is typically I like to have a solution for all of this. In this case, I could only point at the problems, but I couldn't really come up with the solutions, because the solutions are something that has to be done politically. An interesting question was, how about European Union surveillance, actually? Because aren't they doing more or less the same thing? Which is true. And the problem is that the Charter of Fundamental Rights only applies to anything that's regulated by the European Union. And national surveillance is exempt from any European Union law. It's something that the member states are doing all by themselves. So you're out of luck here. You can possibly argue it through a couple of circles, but it's hard to do. However, 7 and 8 of the Charter are exactly the same wording as the European Convention of Human Rights. And this applies to national security cases. So the relevant court here is actually in Strasbourg. So you could probably end up at this court with the same argument and say, if they already found that this is a violation of your essence in Luxembourg, don't you want to give us the same rights in Strasbourg as well? And these two courts are in kind of a fight about kind of providing proper privacy protection and protection in general. So very likely you can walk up with a German case or with a UK case and or a French case and pretty much do the same thing here. So the judgment will be interesting for European surveillance as well because it's a benchmark and we can hardly argue that the US is bad and we are not doing the same thing. Other solutions are possibly technical solutions. So what Microsoft did with the cloud services and hosting it with the Germans and the German telecom. And there is really the issue that if you can get a technical solution of not having any exits from the US side, you can actually get out of the whole problem. So you can try with encryption or data localization and all this kind of stuff. However, none of this is really a very sexy solution to the whole issue. However, it's something that you can possibly do. Last thing, enforcement, and this is a little bit of a pitch, I gotta confess, is we have the problem so far that we have data protection law in Europe, but we don't really have enforcement. And the problem is that the lawyers don't know what's happening technically, the technical people hardly know what the law says, and then you have a funding issue. So the idea that I have right now is to create some kind of an NGO or some kind of a Stiftung Warentest for privacy to kind of look into the devices we all have and kind of have a structured system of really looking into it and then probably do enforcement as well if you're stuff that you have on your device is not not following European law. I think this is an approach that probably changes a lot of the issues. It's not going to change everything, but this could possibly be a solution to a lot of what we had. And that's kind of what we did in other fields of law as well, that we have NGOs or organizations that take care of these things. I think that would be a solution and probably helps a little bit. Last, before we have a question answer session, a little bullshit bingo to probably get a couple of questions answered right away. So the fourth thing is that a lot of questions are if the European Union does the same thing. I just answered it. Of course they do the same thing and we'll have to do something about it as well. And I hope that my case is a good case to bring other cases against member states of the European Union. The second question is this whole PRISM companies are saying they don't do this. It's absurd because they're all placed under gag orders, or the people that are talking to us don't even have the security clearance to talk about the surveillance system. So it's insane when a PR person comes up and say, I hereby read the briefing from Facebook that we're not doing this, which basically is all we have right now. And that's what a lot of the media is referring to as well. Another thing that Facebook and the US government have argued later is that they weren't asked. They were not invited to the court procedure. The fun thing is both of them totally knew about the court procedure. They just decided not to step in and not to get a party of the procedure. So they were like first like, oh, we don't want to talk about it. And then when the solution, the decision came around, they were like, oh, we weren't asked. Of course, it's a win on paper mainly, but we're trying to get it implemented in practice as well. And there is kind of this argument the European Union has broken the internet, which I typically rebut in, no, the US has broken the internet and the European Union is reacting to it. Another issue that was interesting is that a lot of the US side said that this is protectionism. So the European Union is only enforcing these fundamental rights to hurt US companies, which is funny because I'm not involved in kind of getting more trade to Europe. I'm just like someone interested in my fundamental rights. And secondly, the European politics has done everything to kind of not get this case across. So kind of this idea that this is a protectionist thing is kind of strange too. And the last question, which is kind of what about the cables? What about all the other types of surveillance we have? They're an issue too. In these cases, you just have more issues of actual hacking, government hacking basically, so illegal access to servers and cables, which is harder to tackle with than these companies because we have this private interference. So there are a lot of other issues around here as well. I was just happy to kind of get one thing across and I'm happy for questions as well.
All right. We have about 10 minutes for questions. I would ask you to please line up at the microphones here in the hall. We have 6 microphones. And we have also questions from the IRC. While you guys queue up, I would take one from the internet.
Yeah, just one for the first time. So does TTIP influence any of this?
Basically, not really, because the judgment that was done was on the fundamental right. So if they have some kind of wording in TTIP, it would again be illegal. And there was actually a push to get something like that into TTIP. And as far as I know, this idea was done after the judgment. just a little intro. There, Edry has organized a Ask Me Anything thing at 7 o'clock as well. So if you have specific questions, you can also go there, just as a reminder.
Okay, great. Microphone number 2, please.
Thank you for efforts. The question would be, could US businesses under these findings ever be again employed in critical sectors? For example, public sector, Windows in the Bundestag, for example,
yep.
Stuff like that?
Yep.
Ever?
That's a huge problem, and that's a problem we had for a while. I was talking, I'm mainly talking actually with people in the business area. I'm mainly invited to conferences there. And people were telling me, yeah, we're doing all our bank data on Google now. And I was like, what the fuck? Because this is not only privacy, that's also trade secrets, all of this kind of stuff. And so there is this huge issue. And if you talk about like the new Windows that is talking home a little more than the old did, you probably have the same issue here because Microsoft is falling under the same thing.
No plausible deniability, therefore culpability.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, microphone number three, please, for the next question.
How would you assess Microsoft saying they put up a huge fight that they, well, they said they had a customer's data in Ireland and they said they refused to give it to the FBI? What's to think of that?
I think, to be fair, a lot of these companies have realized that there is an issue and that they're the Feuermarsch. But the, and Microsoft, actually a couple of the Microsoft people is talking to me and is like, we're actually not unhappy about this case because we have a good argument in the US now that we're getting troubles here. But the companies are between these two chairs. The US law says we kill you if you're not giving us all the data. And the problem so far is that in the European Union, in, for example, in Austria, the maximum penalty is 25,000 euro if you don't comply with this.
Peanuts.
Which is absurd. And in most other countries, it's the same. We now have the data protection regulation that is coming up, which gives you a penalty of a maximum of 4% of the worldwide turnover, which is a couple of millions. And if you want to thank someone, there is Jan-Philipp Albrecht, probably in the room or not anymore, who is the member of parliament from the Green Party that's actually from Hamburg, who has negotiated all of this. And this actually could possibly change a couple of these things. But you have this conflict of laws, and solutions like the telecom thing, that you host the data with the telecom, could possibly allow them to argue in the US that they don't have any factual access anymore, so they can't give the data to the US government. But we're splitting the internet here. And this is not really something I like too much, but apparently the only solution.
Okay, thank you for your question. We have another one at microphone four, please.
My question is,
I think number four would be me, but anyway.
The guy in back.
Oh, sorry.
Okay, thank you very much for your efforts, first of all, and great result.
Thank you.
The question for me would also be, is there any change in the system in Ireland now? So if somebody has a similar struggle to yours, the next round might be easier or not?
Basically, what the Irish DPC got is a wonderful new building, and the press release is too funny because it says, we have a very nice Victorian building, now downtown Dublin, in a very nice neighborhood, and blah, 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 and they get double the staff of what they had before. The key problem is not none of this. I only took the picture because it kind of shows what's inside the building. And the key problem is that we have two countries, Luxembourg and Ireland, where all of these headquarters are. And these two countries are not interested in collecting taxes. They're not interested in enforcing privacy law. They're not interested in any of this. And they're basically getting a huge bunch of money on the back of the rest of the European Union. And until this actually changes, and there is a change of attitude in the Irish Data Protection Commissioner, it doesn't really matter in which building they are. So they got a lot of more money to kind of, to the public, say, yes, we have more money and we have more staff and da-da-da-da-dum.
But the system did not change.
The big question is what the system is doing. They can prove now, as they have the new complaint on their table on Safe Harbor and Prism and Facebook, they can prove if they do something about it or not. My guess is that they'll find some random reasons why, unfortunately, they couldn't do anything about it. We'll see.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. It's your turn, microphone number two.
Okay, thank you very much, and also thank you for your service for the public.
Thanks for the support.
And what that will, sorry, but the English word...
Sonst auf Deutsch.
Ja, bedeuten fällt mir gerade nicht ein. whatever. Was bedeutet das eigentlich für die Geschichte mit der Vorratsdatenspeicherung, wenn die jetzt wieder kommt? Und inwiefern wird die Social Media damit jetzt sozusagen freigestellt wieder oder nicht?
Ich muss ehrlich sagen, I didn't really look in the German data retention thing too much. Mm-hmm. To be honest, being an Austrian, I'm like, our Supreme
Me too.
Constitution, yeah, I heard. Yeah. Our constitutional court kind of killed it. So yeah. I don't think we'll see a data retention in Austria too soon. But for Germany, it's going to be interesting, especially if you find a way to go to Luxembourg in the end. Like if you find some hook to say, actually, this German law violates something in the data protection regulation or in the directive, so we can probably find a way to go back to Luxembourg, could help. The other thing is that just the fact that the Luxembourg court has been so active has probably boosted up a lot of the national courts as well. Because the German decision, I had the feeling, was like a, we don't really feel like we can fully say that this is actually illegal, and we kind of argue that it's somehow not illegal the way it is, but possibly you can do it in the future, and after Luxembourg has like really thrown all of this right out of the door and was like, get lost with your data retention thing, and especially with the Prism thing, you probably have better case law now as well. And that could be relevant for national courts as well, because of course, these things are a question of proportionality. And if we ask everybody here in the room what they think is proportionate or not, everyone has another opinion. And therefore, it's relevant what our people are saying and what other courts are saying to probably get the level of what we feel is proportionate somehow a little bit up.
So thank you very much, and go on.
Thank you.
Okay, just for the record, in case you couldn't tell by the answer, the question was about the implications for the data retention laws, like in Germany and Austria. Microphone number one, we have another question.
Hi, two questions. One, could you tell a little bit more about your idea of Stiftung Datenschutz Europe-wide, and how do we get funding to you?
Send me
if you don't mind. Second question, when I argue with people about, like, let's keep the personal data of our activists within Europe, I always get this answer, yeah. Are you so naive? Do you think it's anything different if the server stands in Frankfurt instead of San Francisco? What do you say to that?
The same problem. Like, pretty much what we had is, and that's the reason why I said I hope this judgment is used for national surveillance in Europe as well. Because we do have the same issues. I mean, when you are an Austrian and the German Untersuchungsausschuss is basically saying, oh, we're only protecting Germans. I feel like my fucking data is going through Frankfurt all the time. So, and I'm kind of out of the scope, apparently. So we do need to take care of this as well. I hope that this is a case showing that you can actually take action. You just have to poke long enough and kind of poke at the right spot, especially. And I think this is something that there is not an ultimate solution to it. It's just one of the kind of holes that you have. The other thing that we may see is that a lot of companies that are holding this data are much more questioning an order they get. Because if they get legal problems from an order they got by a German court or whatever it is, they probably are now more interested in actually looking at it. Because right now it's cheaper for them to just forward the data. You don't need a whole legal team reviewing it all. So I think to kind of split the private companies that are helping them from the government and kind of get some issue between them probably helps there as well. But of course, it's just like little peanuts you put in there. But in the end, you have that issue in the end. Yep. On the Stiftung Warn Datenschutz or whatever, I think that's kind of a thing I just wanted to blow out to people here because I'm mainly in the legal sphere and in like the activist slash consumer side. And I think that's the big problem we have in the legal and consumer side is that we don't understand the devices that much. And we lack the evidence. We don't really have the evidence of what's actually going on device. And you need to have this evidence if you go in front of courts. And I think a lot of the people in the room probably have this evidence somewhere on their computer. So the idea of really getting this connection at some point, it's not something I can pitch to you right away because it's not like I don't want to start it tomorrow. But it's something I wanted to circulate to get feedback as well, what you guys think of it. So if there's any feedback on it, send me an email or Twitter or whatever it is. Yeah.
All right. Take care. So we do have a bit time left. Microphone number two with the next question, yep. Please.
What can I do as an individual person now? Can I sue Google or can I sue other companies just to stop this? And would it create some pressure if yes. I do that? So what can the ordinary citizen do now?
We're right now, I've already prepared it, but I didn't have time to send it out to have complaints against the Googles and all the others that are on the prison list. We started with Facebook because I kind of know them the best and, you know, it's always a good start. And the idea was really to have other people probably copy-pasting this. The complaint against Facebook we actually filed with the Hamburg DPC as well and the Belgium DPC. The idea behind it was that the Irish now suddenly have two other DPCs that are more interested in enforcing the law in their boat, so they're not the only captains anymore. And it's interesting what's going to happen here. If there are other people that have other cases and just file a complaint with your data protection authority, a lot of them, especially the German data protection authorities, most of them, are really interested in doing something about it, but they oftentimes just need a case. They need someone to complain about it and someone giving them the evidence and kind of someone arguing it to get things started. So if anyone is using Google Drive or something like that, let's go. And basically the wording is on our webpage. You just have to download it and reword it. We're going to probably publish on the website the complaints against the other companies as soon as they're out, probably in the next 2 or 3 weeks, something like this. So just copy paste and spread the love.
Okay, thank you very much, Max, again, for your great talk. This is it.